Un cuito. Ông luôn bị đẹp các bạn to cái trong đa ca này tiếp thì sạm đa ca về lời đi đòn nhiệt tì sạp về nhà làm bài miền đọc ca là phòng ca phơ ấm nàm nàng to từ nâng ca chấm to rồi bỏ về từ vì trong bài cấm chấm phụ ai cơ xá nâng nóng ạ tầm phụ ốp ạ sầm quán
A. Pram สัปดาห์นี้มีระยะเวลา 1 ชั่วโมงในក្នុងការធ្វើការអំណះអំណាងតបនេះសូមអញ្ជើញបាទសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធានតំណាងសัปดาห์នេះដែលមានរូបខ្ញុំហើយនិងសហការីរបស់ខ្ញុំគឺលោកស្រីហ្វាគនីដេបណេត មានពេលវេលាមួយម៉ោងដើម្បីឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងការលើកឡើងរបស់មេធាវីកាប់ក្តីនេះហើយជាចុងក្រោយពេលវេលាដែលនៅសេសសល់គឺលោកវិលៀមស្មីតគាត់នឹងលើកឡើងបន្ថែមទៀតបាទតំណាងសហប្រជាជាតិសូមជម្រាបជូនអង្គសាវនាការថាឯកសារដែលមាននៅក្នុងឧបសម្ព័ន្ធ 5 របស់ការិយាល័យសហប្រជាជាតិគឺជាសារព័ត៌មាន និងសេចក្តីថ្លែងការណ៍ជាសាធារណៈនានារបស់កម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យឯកសារទាំងនេះមានប្រភេទខុសគ្នាជាច្រើនហើយឯកសារទាំងនេះគឺត្រូវបានដាក់ជាក្រុមៗផងដែរឯកសារនេះមានដូចជាការផ្សាយតាមវិទ្យុរបាយការណ៍ឬក៏សេចក្តីថ្លែងការណ៍ផ្សេងៗដែលធ្វើឡើងដោយមន្ត្រីរបស់កម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យឬក៏ស្ថានទូតឬក៏ក្រសួងនានាជាដើមហើយ ក៏មានផងដែរនៅប្រតិបត្តិសារព័ត៌មានផ្សេងៗដែលធ្វើឡើងដោយស្ថានទូតរបស់កម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យនៅឯបរទេសផងដែរមានរបាយការណ៍របស់សេវាផ្សព្វផ្សាយព័ត៌មានបរទេសជាច្រើនត្រូវបានដាក់បញ្ចូលនៅក្នុងឧបសម្ព័ន្ធ 5នេះដូចដែលលោកលោកស្រីចាប់ក្រុមបានជ្រាបហើយអំពីការដាក់ឯកសារស្តីពីសេវាផ្សព្វផ្សាយព័ត៌មានបរទេសដែលហៅកាត់ថា
FBIS នេះសេវាផ្សព្វផ្សាយព័ត៌មានបរទេសនេះត្រូវបានគ្រប់គ្រងដោយទីភ្នាក់ងារសើបការសម្ងាត់សហរដ្ឋអាមេរិកចាប់តាំងពីឆ្នាំ1961ដល់ឆ្នាំ2004ហើយទីភ្នាក់ងារសម្ងាត់នេះបានគ្រប់គ្រងបានបកប្រែនិងបានធ្វើប្រតិចរិកទៅលើព័ត៌មាននិងបទអធិប្បាយពីសន្តរកថានយោបាយបរទេស ពីការផ្សព្វផ្សាយព័ត៌មានតាមវិទ្យុនិងទូរទស្សន៍ពីទីភ្នាក់ងារផ្សព្វផ្សាយព័ត៌មានបន្តកាសែតនិងទស្សនាវដ្តីផ្សេងៗផងដែររបាយការណ៍របស់សេវាផ្សព្វផ្សាយព័ត៌មានបរទេសនេះគឺយើងអាចចូលមើលបានតាមប្រព័ន្ធអ៊ីនធឺណិតនៅតាមបណ្ដាសាកលវិទ្យាល័យជាច្រើនជាពិសេសនៅបណ្ណាល័យរបស់សាកលវិទ្យាល័យ Harvard ជាដើមហើយរបាយការណ៍របស់សេវាផ្សព្វផ្សាយព័ត៌មានបរទេសនេះគឺមានចាប់ពីខែមករាឆ្នាំ 1975 ដល់ខែមករាឆ្នាំ 1979 លើកលែងតែរបាយការណ៍សម្រាប់ខែធ្នូឆ្នាំ 1977 ដែលត្រូវបានដាក់ដោយការិយាល័យសហប្រជាជាតិដែលមាននៅក្នុងសំណើរបស់សហប្រជាជាតិសូមឲ្យដាក់របាយការណ៍ស្តីពីការផ្សព្វផ្សាយព័ត៌មានបរទេសបញ្ចូលក្នុងសំណុំរឿង ដែលបានដាក់កាលពីថ្ងៃទី12ខែវិច្ឆិកាឆ្នាំ2900ហើយ សំណើនេះត្រូវបានចុះលេខឯកសារគឺ D262 ចំណែកឯរបាយការណ៍សម្រាប់ខែធ្នូឆ្នាំ 1977 នោះគឺត្រូវបានដាក់បញ្ចូលក្នុងសំណុំរឿងរួចហើយដែរគឺនៅថ្ងៃទី 31ខែកក្កដាឆ្នាំ 2009 ការផ្សាយព័ត៌មានបន្តដែលសេវាផ្សព្វផ្សាយ
នេះគឺជាសេចក្តីថ្លែងការណ៍របស់
ក្រសួងការបរទេសនៃកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យហើយចំណែកឯកសារលេខរៀងទី35នៃឧបសម្ព័ន្ធ5របស់ការិយាល័យសហប្រញ្ញានេះគឺមួយទៀតគឺជាការដកស្រង់ព័ត៌មានរបស់ប្រព័ន្ធផ្សព្វផ្សាយអន្តរជាតិពោលគឺសេចក្តីសង្ខេបព័ត៌មានរបស់ពិភពលោកដែលហៅកាត់ថា BBC SWB កាលពីថ្ងៃទី3ខែមករាឆ្នាំ1978 ដែលបានដកស្រង់នៅសេចក្តីថ្លែងការណ៍របស់ក្រសួងការបរទេសនៃកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យដែលបានធ្វើឡើងកាលពីថ្ងៃទី31ខែធ្នូឆ្នាំ1977នេះហើយបើយើងពិនិត្យទៅលើខ្លឹមសារនៃការដកស្រង់របស់ប្រព័ន្ធផ្សព្វផ្សាយព័ត៌មានអន្តរជាតិនេះគឺវាដូចគ្នាទៅនឹងអ្វីដែលមាននៅក្នុងសេចក្តីថ្លែងការណ៍របស់ក្រសួងការបរទេសកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យអញ្ចឹងដែរ ហើយតទៅនេះខ្ញុំសូមដកស្រង់ខ្លឹមសារត្រង់សេចក្តីសម្រេចរបស់ក្រសួងការបរទេសដែល SWB បានដកស្រង់តាមមានដូចតទៅក្រសួងការបរទេសនៃកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យសូមធ្វើសេចក្តីថ្លែងការណ៍ដូចតទៅនេះទី 1 រដ្ឋាភិបាលកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យសម្រេចកាត់ផ្តាច់ទំនាក់ទំនងការទូតទាំងស្រុងជាបណ្ដោះអាសន្ន ជាមួយសាធារណរដ្ឋសង្គមនិយមវៀតណាមចាប់ពីថ្ងៃទី31ខែធ្នូឆ្នាំ1977រហូតដល់កងទ័ពឈ្លានពានទឹកដីរបស់សាធារណរដ្ឋសង្គមនិយមវៀតណាមដកចេញពីទឹកដីដ៏ពិសិដ្ឋរបស់កម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យរហូតដល់ទំនាក់ទំនងរវាងប្រទេសទាំងពីរស្ថិតក្នុងបរិយាកាសមិត្តភាពដូចដើមវិញទី 2 អ្នកការទូតនិងបុគ្គលិកស្ថានទូតរបស់សាធារណរដ្ឋសង្គមនិយមវៀតណាមដែលមានការទទួលស្គាល់ពីកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យត្រូវតែចាកចេញពីកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យនៅមុនថ្ងៃ 7ខែមករាឆ្នាំ1978ជាកំហិតអញ្ចឹងយើងឃើញថាឯកសារទាំងពីរនេះគឺវាមានភាពស៊ីសង្វាក់គ្នាដែលអាចបញ្ជាក់ឲ្យបានអំពីភាពជឿជាក់នៃឯកសារ ដូច្នេះនៅក្នុងឧទាហរណ៍ដ៏សាមញ្ញដែលបានលើកអំឡែងមិញគឺជាការបញ្ជាក់ថាมันមានហេតុផលអ្វីដែលតម្រូវឲ្យអង្គជំនុំជម្រះកោះអញ្ជើញអ្នកសរសេរអត្ថបទឬក៏អ្នករាយការណ៍ព័ត៌មាននោះមកនៅធ្វើសក្ខីកម្មនៅចំពោះមុខអង្គជំនុំជម្រះនេះទេហើយជាបន្តទៅទៀតនេះគឺសូមអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យសហការីអន្តរជាតិរបស់ខ្ញុំនឹងលើកឡើងបន្ថែមតទៅទៀតបាទសូមអរគុណ
Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, Your Honours. Good morning to everyone in the courtroom and to anybody watching these proceedings. Annex 5 contains 343 documents. Over one-third of them emanate from the FBIS, the Foreign Broadcast Information Service. 50 of these reports were placed on the case file by the OCIJ and were also admitted in case 001. FBIS reports follow a standard format. At the top of the page, there will be a date, the word Cambodia, and the letter H followed by a number. Some of the reports contain a table of content. The table lists the countries being monitored for that report. A letter is ascribed to each country. Cambodia's letter is always H. The FBIS reports provide translations and transcriptions of daily broadcasts from dozens of locations. They monitored broadcasts from Hanoi, Algeria, Peking, Aden,
Algiers, Hong Kong.
The FBIS also monitored broadcasts in Cambodia. By translating and transcribing the actual broadcasts made on a specific date at a specific location at a certain time, the reports provide an invaluable snapshot of the past. Let's go back in time. What was happening in Cambodia on 26 February 1975? Let's listen in. Before we do so, let me provide you with the document number, ERN
numbers.
I refer to document D108/43/1. The ERN number for in Khmer is 0024238. In English, it is 0016672. In French, it is 0028-1432. Now we can listen in to what was happening in Phnom Penh, February 26, 1975. Khieu Somphon chairs NUFC Congress session communique issue. Text. On 24 and 25 February 1975, the Great National Congress held its second session in an area of the liberated zone under the chairmanship of Mr. Khieu Somphon, RGNUC Deputy Prime Minister, Minister of National Defense, and CPNLAF Commander-in-Chief. This second session of the Great National Congress was held at a time when military, political, and economic conditions have altered significantly in an extremely favorable manner for the Cambodian nation and people's liberation struggle. Now that we are launching our offensive from all sides, the enemy is on the verge of collapse in every field. Phnom Penh is completely surrounded, and the enemy is suffering agonizing military, political, and economic setbacks and ammunition shortages. In these extremely favorable circumstances, the Great National Congress deliberated seriously and thoroughly for 2 days and issued pronouncements on various important matters, including the following. One. Concerning the seven traitors in Phnom Penh, the National Congress has decided as follows. Traitors Lon Nol, Sirik Matak, Sonok Pan, Cheng Heng, In Tam, Long Boret, and Soternos Fernandez are the chieftains of the traitors and ringleaders of the treacherous anti-national coup d'etat which overthrew the independence, peace, and neutrality of Cambodia. They are the ones who induced the U.S. imperialists to invade and set Cambodia aflame, bringing unprecedented, untold destruction and suffering to Cambodia and death to many monks and people, including men, women, and children. On behalf of the NUFC, RGNUC, and CPNLAF, the National Congress declares it absolutely necessary to kill these seven traitors for their treason against the nation and their fascist, corrupt, original acts, criminal acts, unprecedented in Cambodian history. The fourth page of that document, for the second session of the National Congress of the NUFC and RGNUC, Chairman of the National Congress signed Khieu Somphon. The ERN numbers for that last quotation in Khmer 0024231414. 0016675 0028 1435. The denunciation of these seven permeates the broadcasts and can be found in many FIBIS documents. Finally, after the fall of Phnom Penh, those of the seven that remained in the country were executed. This was reported in various documents, including an Amnesty International report of 75 and 76, stating that Yang Sirik was disgusted with the fate of these seven. The report from Amnesty International is D84-Annex A-01. The Khmer ERN is 0059-7825, English 00004213, French 00679-34. The report states, early reports concerned seven leaders of the former Lon Nol government termed, quote, supertraitors, unquote, and condemned to death by the Second National Congress of the Cambodian people in February 1975. Four of the seven had fled the country before the Liberation Army entered Phnom Penh. In November 1975, Deputy Premier Yang Seri confirmed during a visit to Bangkok that three leaders of the former regime had been executed. They were former Premier Long Boret, Prince Sisawat Sirikmatak, and Lon Nol, brother of former President Lon Nol. The second subsect of Annex 5, containing approximately 60 documents, emanate from the BBC. You can never be sure who's listening.
BBC,
it's not just
BBC,
the FBIS, it's also the BBC. It monitored broadcasts. Its reports, known as the Summary of World Broadcasts, often captured similar information to that found in FBIS and in other public declarations and statements contained in Annex 5. These documents also provide invaluable glimpses into the Cambodia of 35 years ago, given the broad range of material facts that need to be proven at an international criminal trial, and particularly one of this breadth and magnitude. These summaries contribute to creating a vista of detailed facts. Among other things, they tell us who the leaders were, what roles they played, what they said, and when. Annex 5 contains over 60 such documents, more than one-third of them were admitted in case 001. The summaries also follow a similar standard format. The letters SWB appear at the top left-hand corner. Sometimes the letters are preceded by the full title. There is a notation in the middle and the date at the top right-hand corner. I will take your honors to one document. Document D56-doc.084. This is an SWB report. The Khmer ERN is 00725158 and 59, English 00008307, French 00749908. The SWB report heading is Nguyen's visit to Cambodia. Abstract of reports. U Nguyen, President and Chairman of the State Council of the Socialist Republic of the Union of Burma, left Rangoon on 26 November for Cambodia. And the following paragraph, Nguyen and his delegation were welcomed on arrival in Phnom Penh by several thousand people, including Q Sumphon, Chairman of the State Presidium, Nguyen Chair, Chairman of the Standing Committee of the Cambodian People's Representative Assembly, Yang Seri, Deputy Premier for Foreign Affairs, Bon Vet, Deputy Premier for Economic Affairs, Son Sen, Deputy Premier for National Defense. In honor of this visit, Q Sumphon later gave a speech welcoming Nguyen on behalf of the people, government, and State Presidium of Democratic Cambodia. He also articulated the key concerns of the regime at that time. A day later, on 27 November, Nguyen visited Siem Reap, accompanied by Yang Seri. They were welcomed at Siem Reap
ពួកគេត្រូវបានទទួលស្វាគមន៍នៅអាកាសយានដ្ឋានសៀមរាបដោយលោកខៀវសំផន
សេវាផ្សព្វផ្សាយក្នុងស្រុកIS Fibis
that Fibis report can be found at document D262.36
the English ERN 0016-8603 the French ERN D262.36
ឯកសារ D26/2.06សំកែប្រាក់ D26/2.26
states Phnom Penh, 30 November 1977. Radio reports Nguyen trip to Siem Reap, Angkor area. Phnom Penh domestic service in Cambodian, 2300 GMT, 28 November 77. Text. On 27 November, His Excellency President Yu Nguyen of the Socialist Republic of the Union of Burma and his delegation, accompanied by comrades Deputy Prime Minister Yang Seri and Met, Chairman of the Air Department, went to the Siem President Nguyen was warmly welcomed at Siem Reap Airport, which was decorated with the colors of the two countries and many red flags by Comrade State Presidium Chairman Khieu Samphan, Deputy Prime Minister Son Sen, Chairman of the Northern Region Committee, King Chap, and cadres of the Northern Region. A third document that also talked about this visit can be found in document D133.2. François Cochot, author of the book Year Zero, discussed this visit at a conference on Cambodia in Oslo in 1978. The French ERN for that is 0023635 2, English 00610802. The translation for the last two documents are not yet available in Khmer. Mr. President, in your honors, there are various subcategories under Annex 5. I believe you have heard enough for now. My colleague, Mr. William Smith, will now address the court. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honours. Good morning, Mr. President. Good morning, Council, civil parties, and the general public. Your Honours, my colleagues have referred to some specific documents showing again the specific indicia of reliability of these documents by cross-referencing them with other documents and showing that internal consistency within them. I would now like to address some of the objections by the defence, specifically and in the more general manner they raised today. In relation, there seems to be an issue that with the defence, particularly with the Nguyen Chia team and the Yang Seri team, that the prosecution somehow hasn't shown the relevance of these documents. As Your Honours are aware, on the 19th of April 2011, we have submitted this court 20 annexes, and in those annexes we submitted a description of the document and a column stating the relevance to the various parts of the indictment. In that column, we relate each document to the paragraph number and the page number of the indictment, and we relate it to the issues that Your Honours have said would be dealt with in the first trial. And just so everyone is aware, the issues in the first trial are historical background, administrative structures, communication structures, military structures, and the factual findings of the joint criminal enterprise. And at this stage, it's limited to the implementation of one of those policies, namely the forcible transfer. And I note that, and it was raised by my colleague earlier, in the severance order, Your Honours had stated the trial chamber did not exclude the possibility of adding additional charges or counts to the first trial in case two were circumstances permit. But in relation to the documents raised by the Nguyen Chia team in questioning their relevance, they refer to a document that related to the S21 and a document that related to the Ministry of Social Affairs. The way the CPK authorities communicated through to their security apparatuses as to any other places is part of the communication structure. It gives us an idea of how the organization works. The fact that it's talking about the document is referring to a security center policy or security centers, that relates to the general policies of the CPK, which is subject to this first trial. There was objection raised that somehow or another, if a document made reference to communication structures after the force transfer, somehow or another, they were not relevant. As Your Honours are well aware, we look at structures before the particular crime, and we look at the structures after the particular crime to try and determine what was that communication structure when that forcible transfer occurred. Your Honours, that's why they are being put forward. Particularly in relation to the Yang Sari defence, his main objection, certainly to this group of documents, and it seems to be to all of them, is what is the relevance of all the documents we've put forward. We have stipulated that in our filings nearly a year ago. It was up to the defence this week, Your Honours, to put forward to the chamber why our stipulation of relevance somehow wasn't valid, why it wasn't prima facie valid. And that hasn't been done, Your Honours. And for us to go through every document in Annex 5 and Annex 1 to 5 again and read out the particular relevancy is really, would be a ludicrous situation and not a good use of court time. We've established the relevance, it was up to the defence to say that we had got it wrong. And we would submit that because of that detailed analysis that was provided to the Chamber, that in fact the prima facie, the position put forward by the prosecution and the fact that it's been related to those areas of the indictment in the first trial, Your Honours should accept that at face value. The Nguyen, in terms of reliability, the Nguyen Chia team keep demanding for the originals of documents and say that if the originals are not produced, none of these documents can be admitted. Your Honours have recognised this fact, you've ruled on this issue, that originals are not required to be produced before this court. And the decision that Your Honours made is not alone, it's a decision that's supported by the practice at international tribunals, and the reason why it's supported is that if originals were brought before the court or had to be, or necessary for admissibility, for every single document in the case, the case would never end. It's not a legal requirement. The fact that the Nguyen Chia defence would like to see every original in the courtroom is not your consideration. Your consideration is, do you believe there's a minimum number of indicators to conclude that that document is reliable? The Nguyen Chia team today, particularly in relation to Annex 5 and seemingly by the National Council, tended to expand this objection to all of the documents from Annex 1 to 5, is that he put forward the issue that how do we not know that all of these documents are manufactured, all of them, Annex 1 to 5. And yet, at the same time, there's no factual basis that he puts forward to give Your Honours any doubt that what you see is somehow manufactured. And yet, because of all of these documents relate to documents that the accused would have a familiarity with because they were at the head of the CPK between 1975 to 1979. The accused statements, we would expect that any one of the counsel would come forward and say, our client states these statements are false. He didn't make those statements. No one has said that. In relation to the CPK publications, none of the defence have said that these publications are false, and they would know. I mean, the accused would know. And none of them have said that. Similarly with the DK communications, the meeting minutes, and the DK media and public statements. As Your Honours, as we've put forward earlier, the test is, are the documents prima facie relevant? We have put that relevancy in our document list, and none of the accused have shown that the documents are not relevant. And secondly, in relation to their reliability, I think it's probably fair to say now that listening to the presentations of the prosecutors this week, that internally, the documents are consistent within themselves. Nearly all of the groups show all the hallmarks of authentic documents. And then when you look at those documents and you compare them to all of the other documents, all the documents are saying the same thing. They're reiterating the same policies. They're reiterating the same roles and positions of the accused. It's very hard to find any document that's completely inconsistent with the other body of documents. And the prosecution would be asking Your Honours to be looking at that, the broad context of the documents, rather than just one document individually. Because under the international jurisprudence, it's clear that to prove the chain of custody from discovery to the courtroom, it is not required. It may well be the case in other cases, and we may hear this afternoon from the Yang Sari team, what he did in his case at the ICTY. And in many cases, witnesses will come before the court to show chain of custody of certain documents, but not necessarily all of them. And Your Honours have decided, and certainly at a request of the prosecution, that we bring someone from DC CAM, and Your Honours have decided to do that on Monday. And Your Honours have decided to call the telegram operators. Your Honours have decided to call a person from the printing house to show that the revolutionary flags are accurate. Not only have Your Honours decided to call these people to assist in establishing the reliability, but this evidence, in fact, is already on the case file which is now before you. So the prosecution's position is that there is enough indicia of reliability, even in relation to partial chains of evidence, on the case file now to have them admitted now. But in any event, if there was no chain of custody of many of these documents, as much as it is an interesting fact to find out where were they discovered, if there were no people around to provide that chain of custody, it's still up to Your Honours to decide, do they have that minimum indicia of reliability? And as we've discussed earlier, international courts, and I'm sure national courts as well, they look at those internal factors of the document, those internal characteristics, and they look at those external characteristics, how they relate to other events. Have other people said, yes, that looks like the type of document we produce? And when you weigh all those conclusions up together, we would submit, certainly based on the brief demonstration we put forward this week, that Your Honours can find that minimum indicia of reliability is there. I would just wonder how many documents that Your Honours may have picked up, or the parties may have picked up, and applied
នៅពាក្យទីដីទៀតបានដាក់ជូននោះ
Sorry, Your Honor, I thought something was said. But I just wonder how many documents in this case file, and certainly in the list the prosecution has put forward, have Your Honors picked up, have the defense picked up, have the prosecution picked up, or civil parties, and said, this document looks like a fake to me. It just doesn't look genuine. It's completely out of synchronization or out of harmony with the other types of documents. I would submit, and certainly it's the prosecution's position, that every single document we have put forward is consistent with that whole body of evidence. And we would submit that despite what we've heard this week about we need this person, and particularly from the Nguyen Chia team, the documents cannot be admitted unless Yuk Chang testifies. That's not a legal test. They would just like to talk to Mr. Yuk Chang in the courtroom. But it's not a legal test. And Your Honours have decided already to call someone from DC CAN with 15 years' experience. And as Your Honours know, on our list, we put Mr. Yuk Chang, as well as many other people that can authenticate documents, if necessary. But our concern is if it's important to do that, it's important to show some chain of evidence. We don't shy away from that fact. But our concern is that if we go down the road of having to prove the author of every document and show how that document was discovered and passed through the many hands over the last 40 years, you're doing a lot more than you need to do legally. And it's taking Your Honour's minds away or views away from the evaluation of the evidence before you and what does that really mean. And it's very clear, Your Honours, that the prosecution, and we take great exception to the remarks of the National Council of Mr. Nguyen Chia, that somehow or another the prosecution doesn't want to ascertain the truth in this case, somehow wants to mislead you by producing copies of documents. That is not the case whatsoever. We have an ethical obligation, it's our duty, to make sure that the evidence that is put forward in this court is of a certain reliability and of a certain relevance so that Your Honours can ascertain the truth. Ultimately, it's a question for Your Honours. But that is our ethical obligation. Our concern is if the prosecution are not allowed, as is put forward by the Nguyen Chia team, to put forward copies of documents, then we will not be able to get to the end of this case, and we will not be able to put the facts of what happened in light of this indictment to Your Honours. And the problem we have is we're not putting the public's case forward just on the basis that someone wants to see an original. We find it very strange to hear that an accused can only decide on whether a copy is a copy of an original unless he sees the original. Mr. Nguyen Chia held the second highest position in the CPK. He would be innately, intimately familiar with all of these documents. But he's saying, I can't accept it unless I see a colour version rather than a black and white. Your Honours, that is not the legal test of reliability. It's not a requirement that the prosecution or the court has to have an admission from the accused that that document is reliable, that it is what it's purported to be. Your Honours obviously can seek his views on any one of a number of documents, but it is not an essential requirement that the accused determines whether or not a document is authentic or not. He is just like any other person able to provide evidence to that. And the suggestion, Your Honours, we completely disregard that every document, we have to show every document to Mr. Nguyen Chia in the courtroom before Your Honours can make a decision on whether or not they're reliable.
That
is not an accepted practice, and that is not required under the law. It would take forever to do that. There is an obligation, and we would submit your honours on the Nguyen Chia defence team, to talk with their client. They are aware that the documents that the prosecution have been putting forward, they are aware particularly of the documents that have been putting forward since April 2011, and the fact that they can't come to court and say our client thinks they're genuine or our client thinks they're a fabrication. That's their responsibility to communicate with their client. We would submit it's not up to the court to sit through an accused one by one of those 4,500 documents and have him read them in front of us and determine whether or not should be admitted. That is not the criteria of admission. Your Honours, the test, I think it's clear, between the teams, except for the Khieu Samphan defence team, that the test for admissibility of documents, you know, in essence, under Rule 87, is it prima facie relevant and is it prima facie reliable? Yesterday, the defence counsel for Khieu Samphan stated that the admissibility of a document has to be proved by the prosecution beyond all reasonable doubt. Your Honours, that is not correct. That is not the law. And it's not the law for many, many reasons. The prosecution, it doesn't even relate to the prosecution. The test for any party is not to prove the document beyond reasonable doubt in terms of its reliability. It's not to prove it on the balance of probabilities. It's to prove it, is it prima facie, what it purports to be. And all that needs to happen is those indicators be highlighted when necessary by your honours. Because the term prima facie means on its face, at first sight, first impression. And we would submit nothing has been put forward by the defence in substance that these documents that have been put forward are not on their face what they purport to be. Nothing substantial whatsoever. They have asked the court they want more, and they will continue on to ask for more and more and more. And your honours are calling some witnesses in relation to Chain, but the test is, do those minimum indicators suffice? We would not expect, Your Honours, the defence to look at the documents and relate to the court the indicia of internal reliability. We would not expect, Your Honours, the defence to look at how those documents are corroborated by all of the other documents, which the prosecution has done this week by many, many examples, because it's not in their client's interest to do so. Because that shows the indicia of reliability. And when counsel for Yang Sari, when they say that the prosecution is not submitting to the chamber, but the prosecution is giving evidence about the documents, that's just simply not true. The fact that the prosecution is identifying those consistencies in the document that you can see on their face, those stamping, those marks, that syntax, the language, the serial numbers, and the fact that the prosecution is linking that evidence to other documents in the case file that support that fact, we are not giving evidence. We're just highlighting to Your Honours how that evidence supports each other. Obviously, the reason why that objection was put forward, that the prosecution were giving evidence, because that establishes, or that highlights or demonstrates those indicia of reliability. Now that's what the defence would not like to happen. That's what the defence for Yang Sari would not like to see. That comparative analysis, looking at the evidence together, because that establishes the indicia of reliability, and then that means the evidence is admitted. But I must say, I think it's fair to say, in relation to the counsel for Yang Sari, they have reflected the jurisprudence well, in a sense that they put forward to the court two alternative arguments. On the one hand, they say the documents, the reliability of the documents haven't been established. But then they say, look, if your honours believe that that indicia of reliability and relevance has been established, then you should only give it limited weight. And the position put forward by the Yang Sari team is really the position at the international courts, where the issue of the threshold test of admissibility is significantly low, but it's there. On its face, is it reliable? But it leads to a presumption of admissibility in these courts. And in fact, if we turn the issue on its head, and if we look at what the appeals chamber at the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda said about this issue, it will highlight the low threshold and, in fact, the very high threshold of for a document to be inadmissible. And I refer, Your Honours, to the Rotunga decision in the Appeals Chamber, May 26, 2003, at paragraph 266, where the Appeals Chamber states, probative value is separate from admissibility. As the Appeals Chamber has previously indicated, the threshold to be met before ruling that evidence is inadmissible is high. It must be shown that the evidence is so lacking in terms of the indicia of reliability to be devoid of any probative value. In the opinion of the Appeals Chamber, this should not be interpreted to mean that definite proof of reliability is necessary for the evidence to be admitted. According to the Appeals Chamber, provisional proof of reliability on the basis of sufficient indicia is enough at the admissibility stage. So, the law is, Your Honours, that Your Honours should get to see all of the evidence. You should get to see it, particularly in cases of this size, that if you don't see the forest for the trees, if you don't see the full matrix of the evidence, it will be very difficult for you to determine whether or not these accused have the roles that the indictment said they did, whether or not these accused were members of the joint criminal enterprise, whether or not there were structures and communication structures that allowed these accused to communicate with people that perpetrated the crimes. And so when the Nguyen Chia team says, Your Honours, how does this document relate to the forced transfer? That's not really the issue. The issue is, in a case of this size, with leaders at the level that they were, is how is the leader connected to the commission of the crimes? The prosecution have never said that Khieu Samphan or Yang Sari or Nguyen Chia were out herding people out of Phnom Penh, but through their subordinates, through their influence, through their structure, through their decisions, they made that happen. And so most of the documents you will see will not be talking about the forced transfer, but will be talking about how the accused is linked to the crimes. And that is a complicated exercise, and it's important that Your Honours have the full body of evidence before you, because if we just present or put forward two or three documents to say that Khieu Samphan had an influential position or Yang Sari had an influential position, that would not be enough. The prosecution would not find that acceptable in terms of proof beyond reasonable doubt of that fact, unless you had a consistent body of evidence that all points in the same direction, that each of these accused held high-level positions, each of these accused communicated on these criminal policies, and that each of these accused had access to a communication and an administrative structure that allowed them or allowed their subordinates defendants to commit the crimes. Because proof beyond reasonable doubt is another aspect, or the critical aspect, that the prosecution takes particularly seriously. We would not come to this court if there was not enough evidence and submit to you that we have proved this case beyond reasonable doubt. But what we are saying to you, Your Honours, you must let the case be heard. Because if the evidence doesn't come in, unless somehow or another it seems to be significantly problematic or fake or fraud, which we haven't heard from any of the defense, then you will not be able to work out what in fact, you would not be able to work out your decision on this indictment because you won't have enough.
Your Honours, at the beginning of the week, we talked about, and I am concluding, we talked about the importance of documentary evidence. The documentary evidence is seen, particularly contemporaneous documents as we've seen today, is seen particularly important in any court and particularly international courts because it captures the intent of the accused. It captures the workings of the organisation. It captures the facts on the ground so that they can't fade over time. It's recorded. People's memories can be good, but other people's can fade. Other interests can make testimony something a little bit less than perhaps what it could be. And there are a number of factors that, and Your Honours are aware of that. That's why the value of documentary evidence is very high, because as my colleague has said, it takes us back in time and tells us how people were thinking, how people were acting, and how the organisation was working. And that doesn't fade over time. In relation to this matter, one could say, and I think it's been put forward by the Yang Sari team, that you know, how do we sort out, how do I find the needle in the haystack? How do I find that piece of evidence that really is important compared to all the documents that have been given by the prosecution? How do we know what's significant? How do we know what's not? Your Honours, what those 20 annexes is the case that the prosecution is putting forward to say proves the crimes in the indictment. The prosecution says there is not one bit of straw in those lists. They are all needles. They are all needles that point in one direction to the guilt of the accused. And those needles are not a mess, Your Honour. They're not a pile. They have been organised in a filing cabinet, an electronic filing cabinet. They have been organised by description, by type, by date, by author, by document number, and they have been pointed in the direction of every allegation in this indictment. There is nothing obscure about the case. There is nothing massive about the case. The documents are there, they're ordered, the relevance is there, and their reliability is to be seen by stepping back from one document and seeing the forest for the trees. Your Honours, lastly, just one word about duty in this trial. It's absolutely clear, Your Honours have the duty to ascertain the truth to this indictment. That duty is there, of course, because it's a public duty. It's a public duty, it's a duty to the victims, and it's a duty to the accused. It's important that their voice is heard. But to stick blinkers on and not look at the evidence because we don't have an original, or we don't have an author, or we don't have something like this for every piece of evidence is not fulfilling the duty, and it's not applying the legal test. And secondly, Your Honours, the other duty, and I do want to concentrate on this one last minute, there is a duty to the accused. There's a duty to the accused to make sure that
only allegations that have been proven beyond all reasonable doubt are held against the accused. And if they can't be, there should be no conviction or no finding on that matter. But as much as it's a duty to the victims to look at all the evidence, it's a duty to the accused. So that if you make a finding that Khieu Samphan or Yang Sary or Nguyen Chia are responsible for this joint criminal enterprise, it must be based on a consistent body of evidence. We haven't come before this court and said, Your Honours, here's an admission. There's his guilt, or here's five documents, there's the guilt. What we've brought to Your Honours through the investigative judge's file is a pattern of evidence, a consistent body of evidence on every single issue. And we would submit that unless we do that, unless we show that consistent body of those needles, unless we do that, we're not fulfilling our duty so to ensure that whatever judgment Your Honours find is a correct one. And so, Your Honours, I think what we put forward have the correct answer in the memo in terms of this hearing. Your Honours said that the inclination is to accept the evidence and then determine its weight. That is the international practice. And unless Your Honours have any serious doubts about any one of these documents on the file, the test is they must be admitted. And of course, Your Honours satisfy your minds by calling someone from DC CAM, telegram operators, people that were at the printing house of Revolutionary Flag. But what we would ask Your Honours is that Your Honours admit all five annexes, and then subject to any evidence that comes up, to take away from what we believe your first impression is, that the documents are reliable, that unless something like that came up, that the documents remain admitted. And if there's limited weight to be attached because you have some doubts later, Your Honours would just say, we attach little or no weight to that. So we ask Your Honours to reject all of the defence objections to the documents and admit annexes 1 to 5. Unless you have any further questions, Your Honours.
Some Okun Lobatin, but some cabin jet be Sahabrina Botte, Dal, Lok, Ban, Lok Bonghain, no Chong Grointha, Mate V, Tritai Bonghainta, a Jun Chop Chout, who mean Lok Nun Jiru or Ying Seri Taklunum and Chop Pont and Okrata Cam Room, Kim Chong Sub and Jet Tata, Lok Mian Ban Basa. មានបានមានប្រសាសន៍បែបនេះមែនទេពីព្រោះអានេះខ្ញុំបានស្ដាប់លើជាភាសាខ្មែរដែលបកប្រែមកអញ្ចឹងខ្ញុំសូមលោកជួយបញ្ជាក់សូមអរគុណអាចបញ្ជាក់បានទេលោក William Smith
Thank you, Your Honour. I didn't get completely clearly what you said, but certainly I didn't put forward that the accused have admitted that they were in a joint criminal enterprise. I'm not sure if there was a translation issue.
ហើយបញ្ហានេះបើករណីមិនច្បាស់យ៉ាងម៉េចនោះគឺសូមមេធាវីលោកខៀវសំផនពិនិត្យនៅប្រទេសចរិតឡើងវិញហើយអាចខ្ញុំផ្ទាត់ទាំងភាសាអង់គ្លេសនិងភាសាខ្មែរហើយក្នុងករណីនេះភាសាអង់គ្លេសជាភាសាដើមដែលបានលើកឡើងដោយសហប្រញ្ញារងអន្តរជាតិនេះជាមូលដ្ឋានសំខាន់នៅក្នុងការផ្ទៀងផ្ទាត់រវាងប្រទេសចរិតជាភាសាអង់គ្លេសហើយនិងភាសាខ្មែរ ជាកិច្ចបន្តនេះអង្គជំរះសូមប្រកល់វិទិកាទៅសហមេធាវីនៅមុខតំណាងដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីហើយដើម្បីមានឱកាសក្នុងការ
អាងតបទៅនឹងការចំទាស់ទៅនឹងឯកសារក្នុងឧបសម្ព័ន្ធ A5ដោយក្រុមមេធាវីការពារក្តីហើយអង្គជំនះធម្មជំរាបថាថាមេធាវីនមកដំណាងដើមដឹងដល់នេះមានរយៈពេល
30 Monsieur le Président, je vais. Nous souhaitons que Monsieur Hong Kim-soon prenne la parole en premier et puis je prendrai la parole à sa suite.
បាទអនុញ្ញាតលោកហុងកំសួនជាមេធាវីតំណាងដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋមន្ត្រីទទួលសិទ្ធិសូមអញ្ជើញបាទសហគមន៍កំសួនជាមេធាវីតំណាងដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋមន្ត្រីនេះសូមគោរពលោកប្រធាននិងអង្គសហប្រជាជាតិគ្រប់នៅក្នុងសេចក្តីថ្លែងការណ៍របស់ខ្ញុំបាទតេតងជាមួយនឹងការចំទាស់ទៅលើឯកសារឧបសម្ព័ន្ធ ហើយថានៅក្នុងអង្គសវនាការនេះលោកមេធាវីការពារក្តីលោកសាក់រាញានិងលោកមេធាវីដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋនីតែបានលើកឡើងតាំងពីដំណាក់កាលនៃឯកសារឧបសម្ព័ន្ធ1រហូតមកឯកសារឧបសម្ព័ន្ធ A5នេះគឺមានលក្ខណៈចំទាស់នឹងការគាំទ្ររហ័សប្រហែលគ្នារួចមកហើយ អញ្ចឹងនៅក្នុងនេះខ្ញុំបាទសូមលើកឡើងតែអំពីអំណះអំណាងដែលតាក់ទងជាមួយនឹងឯកសារឧបសម្ព័ន្ធទី5ទៅប៉ុណ្ណោះអំបញ្ញមិញខ្ញុំបានពេលព្រឹកមិញនេះមុនពេលសម្រាកខ្ញុំបានស្ដាប់ឮមេធាវីការពារក្តីលោកនួនជាបានលើកឡើងដដែលតាក់ទងជាមួយប្រហាក់ប្រហែលខ្ញុំបានមិនប្រាប់ពីថាដដែលទេប្រហាក់ប្រហែលគ្នាជាមួយនឹងការចំទាស់ទៅនឹងឯកសារក្នុងឧបសម្ព័ន្ធ 1 2 3 4 ដែលលោកនៅតែទៀមទាថាបើគ្មានឯកសារដើមយកមកបង្ហាញកូនក្តីរបស់លោកឬដោយលោកនួនជាទៀមទាទេនោះគាត់នៅរក្សាជំហរច្រានចោលដដែលក្នុងនេះលោកបានលើកឡើងអំពីការផ្សព្វផ្សាយឬក៏បោះពំផ្សាយជាឯកសាររបស់រដ្ឋាភិបាលហ្វុងឬក្រុងហើយជាចុងក្រោយលោកបានលើកឡើងអំពីថា ឯកសារដែលលោកមិនចាត់ទុកជាបានការនោះពីព្រោះមិនមានឯកសារដើមហើយដែលគ្មានការចុះហត្ថលេខាឬស្នាមមេដៃទៅទៀតក្នុងបរិបទនេះខ្ញុំបាទសូមជម្រាបជូនអង្គសវនាការជាជ្រាបថាក្នុងសម័យរបបកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យឯកសារភាគច្រើនដែលតុលាការនេះបានទទួលតាមរយៈសហចៅក្រមសើបអង្កេតគឺខ្ញុំបាទកម្រឃើញមានស្នាមមេដៃរបស់ ជន់ជាប់ចោតនិយាយរួមមិនឃើញតែម្ដងហើយបើសិនជាមានឈ្មោះក៏ប្រើពាក្យដូចជាប៉ុលពតប្រើលេខាបៈអនុលេខាបៈលោកនួនជាឬដាក់សមមិត្តលេខាបៈសមមិត្តអនុលេខាបៈជាដើមអញ្ចឹងជាសំណួររបស់ខ្ញុំឬក៏ជាចម្ងល់របស់ខ្ញុំបាទគឺសួរថាតើអ្វីទៅដែលហៅថាភាពដើមឬយថាភាពនៃឯកសារដើមនោះ តើរាល់តុលាការទាំងអស់ទាំងតុលាការជាតិនិងតុលាការអន្តរជាតិតើតែយកឯកសារដើមដែលមានទំហំរាប់ពាន់រាប់ម៉ឺនរាប់សែនទំព័រយកមកបង្ហាញនាពេលសវនាការនេះទើបថាយកជាបានការឬមួយទៀតខ្ញុំបាទសង្កេតឃើញថាការចំទាស់របស់លោកមេធាវីការពារក្តីលោកបដិសេធទូទៅភាគច្រើនលោកលើកឧទាហរណ៍មកវិញ នៅឯកសារដែលមិនច្បាស់ឬបង្ហាញលើស្លាយនោះមើលមិនច្បាស់អញ្ចឹងខ្ញុំបាទចង់បាននៅការពិតថាតើឯកសារប្រភេទណាជាឯកសារលេខប៉ុន្មានដែលមិនស៊ីសង្វាក់គ្នាដូច្នេះនៅក្នុងប្រធានបទនៃការចំទាស់ទៅលើឯកសារឧបសម្ព័ន្ធទី 5 នេះខ្ញុំបាទនៅតែយល់ឃើញថាបើយើងនិយាយអំពីឯកសារដើមទោះបីជារូបថតក៏ដោយ ទោះបីជាសំណេរលើក្រដាសក៏ដោយទោះបីជាថតជារូបភាពជារូបភាពភាពយន្តវីដេអូក៏ដោយតើនោះជាការពិតឬក៏ជាឯកសារដើមដែរទេគឺវាចម្លងទាំងអស់អញ្ចឹងឯកសារចម្លងដែលដាក់ចូលមកក្នុងតុលាការនេះតាមរយៈភាគីទាំងឡាយមានភាគីសហប្រជាជាតិភាគីមេធាវីការពារជនជាប់ចោតនិងភាគីដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្បវេណីសូថាតុលាការដែលទទួលយកនោះ
chặt tục chỉ phâu ca tiếng ọt tế. Chân vừa trâu ca miên ca sẵn an bằng thay tiết. Bà sân chỉ ai kì xa nụ, kháng mê thư vi ca phía cái đây, dù thay chỉ ai kì xa viên mình phâu ca. Rư đại lục mê thư vi ca phía cái đây là bỏ lục nôn chía, miên bà xa thả cây nhu lô chỉ ai kì xa là bỏ bạch trà mật. Chân bịa cây nhu lưu bỏ hai lắng, có thất nộp nông bịa xong sai khu luôn ai nổ lại tê. Mới tiết, khi bạn sẽ đạp lưu lục mê thư vi Michael Carnavas, đại chỉ mê thư vi ca phía cái đây là bỏ lục yên xử lý, lục có bàn thay thả, ca dốc ai kì xa tiếng ọ, mộc bằng hai anh, cứ miên bấm non oi khang on chùm nôm chùm ra chưa là mới đạp bẩn túc tới lỡ chân chọc chọc để thật là con cá chọc bạc cani chân nông chùm ho rồi bao lúc còn đâu ta tìm tia thả đầm bây giờ miên phiệp chưa chạ thả miên tổng nguồn tẹt tôn từ nâng đầy ca bình chung lương chùm nôm tâu chùm nôm chùm ra cứ lúc nào để xa ca chùm to đã đài chân sờ đập cái đây móc ngục lục mê thử vi ca pia cái đây oi lục khiêu sầm phón còn lớp bàn lớp láng đá thả ไอ้กษัตริย์โดยนครนงประเทศนบัตแต่ตรงในไอ้กษัตริย์อาปรามนี่จียงใบโรยไอ้กษัตริย์นี่ก็ลูกเน่าแต่ละซาจมโฮปะได้ใส่มาปียะทับเพียบในไอ้กษัตริย์ดาเอลโดยลูกเตรียมเตี้ยยกไอ้กษัตริย์ดามโดยเมติวิกาปีกได้มนต์มนต์ดาเอลจังต่อตอนนี้ชาวบ้านส่วนจมเรียบถ่าเอาไว้แต่ชาวบ้านจังเล็กหลานคือแต่ตรงจมวยหนึ่งไอ้กษัตริย์ดาเอลบอกปุ่มสายหรือไอ้กษัตริย์ดาเอลบังการล้างนกนงระบบการปิจิปิจิตปไตยนี่วิมินชราหนักมินทาแต่ระบบการปิจิปิจิตปไตยมวยเตะระบบดักนวมประเทศนาก่อเมียนไอกระซาเจลีเลอซอไอกระซาและซาตุกเจรูปเพียบเจวีเดโอเจรูปทอดหนึ่งการจมลองตุกได้ประเทศเนียนเลยมีพบโลกได้เกจับอารมณ์อัมพีตงเบอร์หรือกาบสับสายระบบประเทศนิมวยนมวยนุกจังโดยโลกสหปริญญาบันดักล้างบันมันจังกับสับสายตามปอบชุจีตระบอบระบบการปิจิปิจิตปไตยมันแม่นเมียนแต่นกนงประเทศในทวีปอาเซียนเตะจังโดยโลกบานเล็กลางถาสารพอดเมียนบีบีซีสารพอดเมียนนกสหรัฐอเมริกหรือนกประเทศออสเตรเลียหรือนกประเทศนับเป็นฟินติสได้เกิดกัตราตุกหรือเกิดบานทอดจำลองตุกนู่ก็จัดตุกจีไอกระซาพอตามวิสมรับเอาตุลาการปีนึดหนึ่งปีจารณาเนปเปิลโลกจังซาลกรามบริษัทในการจองกระดาษท่าตาเพียบซีสังวะนี่ในกาสับสายนู่จะมวยหนึ่งกาจำลองไอกระซายมระดาโจนวิซีสังวะนี่ได้หรือตีจำบัดซุ่มจำเรียบต้องจำนวนจำแรงบรรดาเตียถาโนขนงไอกระซาได้บอกปุ่มสายโนขนงระบบการปฏิบัติจิตถูกใจบานสับสายเซนหนึ่งอันวัดเซนจังตรังจำได้ไหมให้แต่น้อมเอาคางจนจับจอดเมียนกาปรุยบารัมปรุธาโลกเตรียมเตี้ยเอาสะเปรียบบ่องห้างพิบเจริญหรือพิบยะถาพิบในไอกษาเอาจะบาหลัวเอาเลือกปีวิเมติสองใส่จะมาสู่ถาเมียนจังว่าถาตาเปียถาวิเมติสองใส่หรือเลือกปีวิเมติสองใส่นู่วิเมียนกับรัตนาดังนั้นรอลไอกระซาได้กุปีหรือทอดจำลองโจ้ขนมประปอนอิเล็กทรอนิกส์ในองศาวนาคาองจุ่มนุ่มจุ่มแรกวิสมัยขนมตลาการการปิจินี่โลกประเทศบานจุ่มรีบหนึ่งบานประกาศจีจีพลกาด้วยให้โดยโลกนุนจีบานเตี้ยเตี้ยนขนมสับปะดามมุนมุนรอลเปิลคือโลกเตี้ยเตี้ยอ้อยบ่องหายปีไอกระซาดามสั้นหายไปคละกอดบานปฏิเสธถ้ากาสมพีหรือบอกกอดจุ่มเลือกเตี้ยฮอได้ตายแต่บานยืมให้เจียมวยหนึ่งลูกคำงุนแต่ก็ตายแต่ปัดใส่ตังคาฮาวชมูมันจะไปรอตัวเตี้ยนุก็เหมือนเหมือนปัดใส่ตังสลองเต้ก็ปัดก็กรอนแต่ในยีท้าเจียกาในยีเลงหรือในยีเหมือนตอนยกจากกาปิดให้ก็ตัดโฮดดาวเจ้าท่าคำงุนเจียพเนียร์หรือบอสสำหรับในยุคคนใส่ตัวเตี้ยจังเตียงอ่อนนี่ตาเนื้อเนี่ยวีดำลายท่าเอาไว้ได้จากการในยีเอาไว้ได้จากการกัดตราตุกคือจากการบานกาหรือเจียไอซาเยอะทับเพียบนุยังบ้านสมจุ่มเรียบจูนองสวนาการจิริบถาเพียบไอจะตู้ยกบ้านหรือยะถาเพียบในไอกษาอปาสมปอนปรำหรือก็ไอกษาอีประบุนสละสามสมวยจดปรำนครนองศพสมนมเรื่มนี้บาสันเจมีทวีกาเปียกใดแตงอ๋อโลกเตรียมเตียยกไอกษาดำแตงอ๋อเหม็นเหม็นแตะต้องแต่ไอกษาอาปรำนี่มวยเตะคือไอกษาได้โลกประเทศไต่แต่เมียนประซาถา
mean perhaps it jing mui lien tum poi no no which net ta pale velia rư dam na ka sa vana ka ni ta ta muk tiết no ta pra pale pa man chnam tiết chân khi mát ka chong ban chabah loh dai tha ta ai ka sa chmu rư ai ka sa lêch pa man dai mê ta vi ka pi ka day luk chum toa tha mình ai yok chi ka ban chân mở đoàn là pale ni khi mát nơ ta mình toan ta tuôn ban chạy lẹ nơ lai tha ka chum toa ta lư ឯកសារអាមួយរហូតដល់អា5ដែលខាងសហប្រជាជាតិលោកបានដាក់ជូននោះមិនទាន់មានការពិតចំនួនប្រមាណពិតប្រកបនោះទេដើម្បីឲ្យយើងខ្ញុំទាំងអស់គ្នាក៏បានសិក្សានិងធ្វើការវិភាគជូនជាយោបល់ឬក៏ធ្វើស្ដីថ្លែងការណ៍ជូនទៅអង្គសហប្រជាការណ៍ផងដែរក្នុងនេះខ្ញុំបាទសូមជម្រាបជូនថាដោយសារមេធាវីដើមមិនដឹងរដ្ឋបាលនេះមុនក៏លោកលើកឡើងហើយលោកសហប្រជាជាតិក៏បានលើកឡើងច្រើនហើយដែរតកតងជាមួយនឹងយថាភាពនៃឯកសារនេះ ខ្ញុំបាទនៅតែសូមជម្រាបជូនលោកប្រធាននឹងអង្គសហនការទៀតថាបាននិយាយពីការវាយតម្លៃទៅលើផតាងវិធាននៃផតាងក្នុងមាត្រា271នៃក្រមប្រំពាត់នៃប្រជាណាចក្រកម្ពុជាហើយដែលស្មើគ្នាជាមួយនឹងវិធាន81នៃវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងរបស់អវតកនេះបានចែងថាមាត្រា371ស្ដីពីការវាយតម្លៃលើផតាងដោយតឡាការបានចែងថាលើកលែងបទបញ្ញត្តិផ្ទុយពីនេះ ផតាងក្នុងរឿងប្រមត្តនអាចជូនបានដោយសេរីតឡាការថ្លឹងថ្លែងដោយអិសរជិតអំពីតម្លៃផតាងដែលគេដាក់ជូនមកខ្លួនពិនិត្យដោយផ្អែកលើចំនួនស្មោះត្រង់ពិតប្រកបរបស់ខ្លួនតឡាការសំអាងនៅក្នុងសេចក្តីសម្រេចរបស់ខ្លួនតែទៅលើផតាងដែលមាននៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងឬដែលត្រូវគេយកមកបង្ហាញនៅពេលសវនាការប៉ុណ្ណោះអញ្ចឹងមេត្រា332ស្ដីពីការបង្ហាញវត្ថុតាង ប្រធានសវនាការអាចបង្កប់ឲ្យជន់ណាម្នាក់បង្ហាញវត្ថុតាងបានអញ្ចឹងខ្ញុំបាទបានស្ដាប់ឮមកប្រមាណសប្តាហ៍នេះគឺខាងលោកមេធាវីការពីក្តីលោកទៀមទាឲ្យប្រធានមជ្ឈមណ្ឌលឯកសារកម្ពុជាឬហៅកាត់ថា ខ្ញុំបាទនៅតែយល់ឃើញថាការលើកឡើងរបស់លោកមេធាវីការពីក្តីទាំងអស់ទៀមទាតែម្នាក់គឺខ្ញុំជឿជាក់ថាមិនមែនតែមួយទេហើយបើលោកនៅតែជឿជាក់ថារាល់ឯកសារឬរាល់សាក្សីឲ្យតែកតិនដូចជាការបោះពុំផ្សាយរបស់រដ្ឋាភិបាលហ្វុងឬក្រុងនោះអញ្ចឹងតើមានសាក្សីឬមនុស្សប៉ុន្មាននាក់ទៀតដែលត្រូវមកបំភ្លឺរាល់ឯកសារនោះអញ្ចឹងខ្ញុំបាទសង្ឃឹមថាលោកប្រធាន ដែលបានជម្រាបជូនពីថ្ងៃមុនថានៅថ្ងៃច័ន្ទខាងមុខនេះនឹងមានការបំភ្លឺមិនអាចនឹងបំភ្លឺរាល់ឯកសារទេហើយអ្វីដែលខ្ញុំបាទចង់លើកឡើងពេលនេះគឺខ្ញុំបាទនៅតែរក្សាគោលជំហរដដែលថាឯកសារទាំងឡាយដែលបានដាក់ជូនទៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងរួចមកហើយនេះមិនមែនមានន័យថាសុទ្ធតែឯកសារបានការទាំងអស់នោះទេហើយក៏មិនមែនមានន័យថាឯកសារដែលបានដាក់ជូនហើយនេះសុទ្ធតែឯកសារមិនបានការនោះដែរដូច្នេះខ្ញុំបាទសូម ធ្វើការកត់សម្គាល់ខ្លីៗនេះដោយចំហររបស់ខ្ញុំបាទនៅគាំទ្រការលើកឡើងនិងការដាក់ជូនរបស់សហប្រជាជាតិតេតងនឹងឯកសារអា5នេះនៅដដែលហើយសូមឲ្យលោកប្រធាននិងអង្គសហនការទទួលយកទៅពិចារណាយកជាបានការមុននឹងចេញសាលក្រមនៅចុងក្រោយហើយបន្តទៅនេះសូមអញ្ជើញលោកស្រីអេលីសាបេតបន្តសូមអរគុណសូមអញ្ជើញលោកស្រី
Oui, bonjour Monsieur le Président, bonjour Madame et Monsieur les juges et bonjour à tous. Alors, nous parlons, si j'ai bien compris, de l'annexe 5 et Monsieur le Procureur tout à l'heure nous a expliqué ce qu'étaient les documents de l'annexe 5 qui tous émanent du régime du Cambodge démocratique ou du Khmer ou bien sont des documents qui sont des sortes d'instantanés de presse au moment des événements et qui confirment en quelque sorte ces événements sur le moment. Tout à l'heure, la défense de Yang Sari a indiqué que ces objections Elle fait fi du règlement intérieur, des règles qui ont été rappelées de temps à autre, et notamment à propos de E3. Elle fait fi du code de procédure pénale cambodgien, que pourtant, elle invoque à plaisir lorsque ce code n'est favorable. Elle fait fi de la jurisprudence internationale qu'elle se plaît à souligner, à évoquer, en choisissant les passages choix qui lui sont favorables. Elle fait fi de cette jurisprudence internationale lorsqu'il est démontré que cette jurisprudence indiquait que la défense ne bénéficie pas d'un droit absolu de confrontation. Que la défense ne bénéficie pas d'un droit absolu de pouvoir regarder les origines, d'obtenir la production des origines. Elle fait fi de cette jurisprudence qui a été évoquée à propos de l'annexe 1, qui précise que la Chambre, les juges plus exactement, bénéficient d'un pouvoir discrétionnel. Et lorsqu'on dit les juges, on est obligé, en ce qui concerne le CETC, de penser également au juge d'instruction. La défense fait fi de ce que les procureurs, jour après jour, de façon minutieuse et très détaillée, ont démontré qu'ils avaient appliqué pour le choix des pièces versées au dossier depuis des années, qu'ils avaient appliqué strictement les critères de recevabilité de la jurisprudence internationale précisément. La défense fait fi.
ខ្ញុំសូមជំទាស់នៅពាក្យសម្ដីរបស់មេធាវីដែលបានបង្ហាញរដ្ឋប្រតិភិនីប្រើពាក្យថាមេធាវីការពារងងឹតងងល់ព្រមទាំងជន់ឆ្លីມັນមានជន់ឆ្លីអីទៅលើព្រះញ្ញាឬក៏ទៅលើដើមបង្ហាញរដ្ឋប្រតិភិនីມັນមានទេទាំងអស់នេះជាយុទ្ធសាស្ត្រការពារបស់បតិរបស់ក្រុមមកខាងខាងនេះសូមអរគុណ
Xong chơi và to tiết nữa hay và nhà hát tầm đầu chia ca pra pịa nông ca bọ prae hay bru hờ ca xua tới chi phía xa đọt tầy thiết nâng để chi mình men tùm ngôn này pịa đình chẳng ti và nhà hà ngồ ngất ngồ ngôn là ní kia và nhà hà thông ngôn men hay bà thân chi pra pịa ní chi phía xa khmai và nà xua thang phía xa xe chiến nâng ដូចជាມັນមានធ្ងន់ទម្ងន់ដោយការប្រើពាក្យខ្មែរទីអញ្ចឹងអាចមកពីការបកប្រែប៉ុន្តែទោះបីយ៉ាងណាគឺសូមមេធាវីប្រយ័ត្នប្រយែងក្នុងការប្រើពាក្យធ្វើឲ្យបានធំរំជៀសវាង
Oui, Monsieur le Président, je confirme que je n'ai pas employé le terme désespéré. Je ne me permettrai pas d'employer un tel terme. Et je pense que c'est peut-être une mauvaise traduction du terme obstiné que j'ai utilisé à un moment donné. Je ne vois que cette possibilité. Et je n'entends pas utiliser des termes outrageux, bien entendu. Je voudrais continuer mes observations, qui d'ailleurs ne sont plus très longues. En adoptant cette position d'objection obstinée, la défense fait fi des indices multiples systématiquement apportés jour après jour pendant 4 jours par l'accusation de façon détaillée et pour chaque annexe. La défense fait fi aussi des procès-verbaux d'interrogatoire de certains témoins ou parties civiles en exigeant à nouveau la déposition de ces personnes, ainsi les dépositions devant juge d'instruction n'existent pas, comme si ce procès-verbaux n'était pas, et comme si cette pièce de procédure n'avait pas été définitivement validée par l'ordonnance de clôture. Je pense par exemple au procès-verbaux d'audition de M. Yu-Chang le 19 mars 2009, D-150, ou le 24 juin 2009, D-204-3. De mémoire, d'ailleurs, j'observe qu'il n'a pas été fait une seule demande de confrontation pendant l'instruction, pas seulement à l'égard de ce monsieur, mais également à l'égard de n'importe quelle autre partie. Pas une seule demande de confrontation, en bonne et due forme, sans poser des conditions préalables au juge d'instruction. La défense fait fi aussi du rôle de ce juge d'instruction, bien sûr. Et la défense fait fi, et nous fait perdre beaucoup de temps à cause de cela, de la jurisprudence des chambres extraordinaires. Et je ne prendrai qu'un seul exemple pour montrer que des questions qui sont présentées strictement de la même façon aujourd'hui ont déjà été évoquées et déjà jugées. Ce qui veut dire que si la défense veut aujourd'hui à nouveau évoquer ces questions, il faudrait qu'elle trouve de nouveaux arguments. Et je parle par exemple de l'arrêt de la chambre préliminaire du 30 novembre 2010, D-402-1-4, qui concerne justement les documents de DICICAM. Et dans le paragraphe 25, la chambre préliminaire précise que durant la phase préalable, ce sont les co-juges d'instruction à qui il appartient de se prononcer sur la crédibilité d'un document. Et ensuite, la chambre préliminaire rappelle à la défense que si, au cours de la phase de l'instruction, les juges d'instruction doivent s'acquitter de nombreuses obligations. Je cite, ils ne sont en aucun cas tenus de fournir des précisions ou autres éclaircissements concernant le recueil d'éléments de preuve, pas même lorsque ces éléments proviennent de sources spécifiques. Ce que je veux dire par là, c'est qu'on ne peut pas, aujourd'hui, procéder comme le fait la défense, en reposant systématiquement les mêmes questions, sans tenir compte des réponses qu'elle a déjà obtenues, et sans aller plus loin. Cela dit, et pour terminer, je crois que cette répétition des objections de 3 à 5, a eu au moins deux vertus.
La première de ces vertus, c'est que la défense a été peu à peu jusqu'à l'extrémité absurde de cette stratégie d'objection, puisque, comme le procureur l'a relevé tout à l'heure, la défense de Kieu-Saint-Pan ce matin nous a dit qu'en fait, pourquoi ne pas penser qu'après tout, tous les documents pourraient être des faux. C'est non seulement absurde, mais c'est également choquant. La deuxième de ces vertus de la répétition, c'est que par cette répétition, je crois que finalement, la défense s'est persuadée elle-même qu'on ne discutait plus de recevabilité, mais qu'on discutait vraiment de valeur probante. Petit à petit, on a entendu la défense nous dire qu'il faudra que la chambre examine cela au moment d'examiner la force probante, etc. Et ce matin, la défense de Yang Sa-hui a été beaucoup plus claire puisqu'elle a parlé de l'accusation en indiquant qu'il fallait qu'elle prouve la force probante. On n'était plus du tout dans la recevabilité. Puis la défense de Yang Sa-hui a indiqué que la
Chambre l'a recevabilité et la force probante. ឥឡូវនេះដល់ពេលត្រូវសម្រាកភាសាថ្ងៃត្រង់ហើយប៉ុន្តែមុននឹងសម្រាកអង្គជម្រះសូមចង់បានព័ត៌មានពីអូខេពីភិក្ខុអំពីការប៉ាន់ស្មានពេលវេលារបស់ខ្លួនក្នុងការសួរចម្លើយជនជាប់ចោតនួនជា ដោយសម្រាប់អង្គហេតុវគ្គទី1គឺស្ដីពីប្រវត្តិកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យហើយនៅក្នុងកិច្ចដំណើរការសហការចុងក្រោយគឺខាងសហប្រញ្ញាបានបង្ហាញជំហររួចហើយហើយថាខ្លួននៅមានពេលត្រូវការពេលវេលាមួយពេលកន្លះថ្ងៃទៀត នេះជាការកត់សម្គាល់របស់អង្គជំរះប៉ុន្តែអង្គជំរះក៏ចង់ដឹងអំពីព័ត៌មាននៅក្នុងការប្រមើលមើលប៉ាន់ប្រមាណពេលវេលាសម្រាប់សួរដេញដោលចំពោះជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាអំពីអង្គហេតុវគ្គ1ប្រវត្តិបកគមនីកម្ពុជានឹងដែរដើម្បីឲ្យអង្គជំរះមានលទ្ធភាពនៅក្នុងការយកមកគិតគូពិចារណាកំណត់អំពីកាលវិភាគសម្រាប់ធ្វើសកម្មភាពឲ្យប្រព្រឹត្តទៅបានឆាប់រហ័សនិងមានប្រសិទ្ធភាព ប៉ុន្តែអង្គជំរះមិនទាន់ចង់បាននាពេលនេះទេអាចថាពេលមុនពេលចប់នៅរសៀលនេះយើងនឹងសង្ឃឹមថានឹងទទួលបានព័ត៌មានអំពីការប៉ាន់ស្មានពេលវេលារបស់ភាគីឥឡូវនេះដល់ពេលវេលាសមល្មមនឹងសម្រាប់ភាសាថ្ងៃត្រង់ហើយអង្គជំរះ
I believe there was a problem with the English translation. When the President referred to the half day, he actually referred to an indication already given by the prosecutors as to what time they still need to conclude their questioning. So the chamber is open for estimates. The half day was repeating the prosecution's estimate.
បាទអរគុណឥឡូវនេះសម្រាប់ពិសាថ្ងៃត្រង់អនុរិយ៍មន្ត្រីខុមខាំងនាំលោកខៀវសំផនទៅកាន់បន្ទប់សម្រាប់នៅខាងក្រោមហើយនឹងឲ្យបង្កប់ឲ្យនាំខ្លួនគាត់ត្រឡប់មកកាន់បន្ទប់សម្រាប់ការវិញនៅរាសេលនេះឲ្យបានមុនម៉ោង 1:30 នាទី